Early in July 1870, the Chancellor of Prussia, Count Otto von Bismarck, one of the most ruthless diplomats in history, was interrupted at dinner by the arrival of a telegram from his king, William I of Prussia. The telegram described how the French ambassador, Benedetti, had been cordially received over a matter of the Spanish succession. The throne had been offered to a member of the Prussian royal family, a cousin of King William. Naturally, France objected to such a candidate, which ignored her own long-standing influence in Spain. King William, with no desire to provoke a war with France, assured Monsieur Benedetti that Prussia would forward no such candidate to the Spanish throne. Pleased with his resolution of the matter, William gave his permission to Bismarck to publish the transcript of the meeting. Yet Bismarck had no intention of giving the French such satisfaction. Indeed, he had been waiting for just such an opportunity to provoke war, and so altered the wording of the telegram to suggest that Benedetti had been dismissed out of hand. The so-called Ems telegram arrived in Paris on the 14th of July, Bastille Day. Its effect was explosive. The French were outraged, and within just 5 days, declared war on Prussia and her German allies. The Franco-Prussian War had begun, and within months, an empire would fall. The Franco-Prussian War of 1870 to 71 was one of the most short-lived yet cataclysmic conflicts of the 19th century. Fought in just a few short months, it saw the destruction of France's mighty Second Empire under Napoleon III. And with it, the end of the old European order that had existed since the defeat in 1815 of the first Emperor of the French, Napoleon Bonaparte. From now on, a new united Germany under the ruthless control of Prussia would dominate the balance of power in Europe before finally driving it headlong into World War I and the horror of trench warfare. The Franco-Prussian conflict ushered in great changes and developments in the way war itself was waged. Observers from the non-combatant European powers looked on in fascination and alarm, as for the first time, industrialization was harnessed to bring unprecedented scale and mechanical precision to warfare.
One of the main military features of the new model Prussian army built up by Moltke and Bismarck was that it really knew how to use modern technology, as well as the well-known bolt-action needle rifle that the infantry had. They really understood the importance of breech-loading steel artillery manufactured by Krupp, and also the importance of mobility, particularly through railways. This was something that the French still did not regard as being immensely important. Although at the beginning of the war they had a much more complex and in some ways superior rifle, the Chassepot, they had balked at the prospect of shelling out more money to revamp the French artillery, and they still had muzzle-loading artillery, and that was really what cost them the war.
Both on and off the battlefield, the way in which nations waged war would never be the same again. Though Germany would rise ascendant from this great power struggle, the Franco-Prussian War would leave France wallowing in the shame of defeat, following the vanquishing of her mighty empire. For a while at least, it had promised a return to the glories of the First Empire. Yet, even in defeat, there would be no respite for France. From the very ruins of the capital city itself would arise the largest violent insurrection of the entire 19th century, the Paris Commune, and the bloody and bitter siege which would lead to its eventual extermination. As if national defeat itself were not enough, France would tumble into the worst of all conflicts, civil war.
I think it's hugely ironic that Napoleon did not learn the lessons of the First Empire in terms of mobility and concentration of troops very quickly. And that lesson was learned very much by the Prussians. I think it's also extremely ironic that Napoleon I understood the crucial importance of artillery on a battlefield and had massed batteries, and the French army during the Franco-Prussian War appeared to not understand that point.
Germany, too, had seen its share of military defeat at the hands of a stronger power only 70 years before. Ironically, it was out of these ashes that the new united Germany would rise to dominate the Western world. The first half of the 19th century was a period of considerable social change and political turmoil in Europe. Throughout the 18th century, Germany was a battleground contested by the three great powers of Austria, France, and Prussia. In 1789, the French Revolution and the wars which followed in its wake swept away many of the old European monarchies, yet triggered a growth in German nationalism. During the Napoleonic Wars, most of the smaller German states were forced by Napoleon Bonaparte to become allies of France. At the battles of Jena and Austerlitz in 1806, the emergent German nations were crushed by Napoleon's Grande Armée. It was this defeat which led to a great pan-German uprising of nationalist feeling. Under influential Prussian leaders such as Scharnhorst and Gneisenau, Prussia led the German states in a war of liberation, and with the aid of the other great powers, drove the French from German soil and secured the final defeat of Bonaparte in 1815. The years which followed saw a gradual strengthening of German unity. The removal of customs barriers between the various North German states was followed by a degree of political cooperation. And then, following a 7-week war with Austria in 1866, Prussia established the North German Confederation. Hanover, the Elbe duchies, and many of the smaller states were annexed, and all the remaining German states north of the River Main obediently placed themselves under Prussian control. Only the four South German states retained political independence, but even they agreed to ally with the Confederation in the event of foreign aggression. The Chancellor and chief architect of the Confederation was Count Otto von Bismarck, a Prussian Junker or aristocrat. One of the most single-minded and unscrupulous statesmen in history, he was dedicated to the cause of German unity and the creation of a Grosser Deutschland.
Otto von Bismarck is frequently seen as a dour German who plotted the downfall of the glorious French Empire, whereas in reality he was an extremely able diplomat and politician who was able to use patience and technology to achieve his military and political goals over the long term in Europe.
To Bismarck, the German Confederation was merely a step on the road to that goal. More still remained to be done. Bismarck felt that a war with France, the preeminent European power, would not only cement the fledgling confederation together, but draw in the southern states as well. In order to win their support, however, an excuse for war was needed. It was necessary for France to be seen as the aggressor.
By 1870, Bismarck was very close to his aim of achieving a united Germany under Prussian domination. But to unite the southern provinces of Germany into one single nation-state, he needed to engineer, or at least take advantage, of a crisis with France. And the Franco-Prussian War, as it later became known, of 1870, gave him the chance to create the German Empire.
Bismarck needed to provoke France, and Benedetti's meeting with the Prussian king, William I, provided just such an opportunity. In reality, the exchange was courteous, but after Bismarck's skillful surgery on the transcript, just as he had anticipated, France rose to the challenge and declared war. The end of the Second Empire was now only months away. Under Napoleon III, France had re-established her preeminence in Europe.
Although Napoleon III was Emperor of France, he was strongly influenced by public opinion, and public opinion was growing more and more in favour of fighting a war to the finish against Prussia, of finishing the unfinished business of 1815.
The nephew of the great Emperor, Napoleon Bonaparte, Napoleon III, saw himself as a man of destiny and attempted two coups against King Louis-Philippe, the last of France's Bourbon monarchs. Both failed, and for a time he took refuge in England. But the revolutions of 1848 enticed him back to France. Elected President of the Republic, he orchestrated a coup d'etat in December 1851, and a year later declared himself Emperor. Thus, France's Second Republic became her Second Empire. Napoleon III was an able politician who brought social stability to France, but his military ambitions would ultimately bring the country to ruin.
In 1866, Bismarck had achieved his aim of establishing a North German confederation dominated by Prussia. He had smashed Austria in a war lasting only 7 weeks, while France, under Napoleon III, could only stand idly by and watch with growing apprehension.
Although he lacked his famous uncle's martial genius, Napoleon III was keenly interested in the technology of war and oversaw a series of reforms. The neglected army was outwardly remodeled on the old First Empire Grand Armée and given back its imperial eagles. All that was needed to restore its pride was triumph on the battlefield. In 1854-55, the army did well against the Russians in the Crimean War, psychologically an important victory, which laid the ghosts of the disastrous invasion of Russia in 1812. 3 years later, himself in command, the new emperor fumbled his way to victory over Austria at the bloody battles of Magenta and Solferino. The days of glory seemed to have returned, and other countries rapidly adopted French-style uniforms and tactics, caught up in the martial splendor of the resurgence of the French army. But then it all began to go sour. A disastrous intervention in Mexico alienated many of France's allies and led to a growing political opposition. Then, in 1866, Prussia's dramatic victory over Austria exposed the need for a proper modernization of France's army. Developments in new breech-loading rifles, such as the French Chassepot and Prussian needle gun, were to prove critical in the coming war.
The War of 1866 had demonstrated the decisive superiority of the Prussian breech-loading rifle, the needle gun, over the muzzle-loading rifles of their Austrian opponents. But the French in 1870 also had a breech-loading rifle, the Chassepot, that was superior to the Dreiser needle gun in many respects.
For over 100 years, the dominant weapon on the European battlefield was the flintlock musket. In the early 1800s, experiments with fulminate of mercury produced what became the percussion cap. Fulminate of mercury was quite simple, you hit it and it exploded. This set off the powder charge in the barrel in the old way, but it laid open the path to greater technological improvements. It was quickly realised that if you put this fulminate of mercury, you could in the actual powder charge itself, you'd be able to get a breech-loading weapon.
When it was introduced in the late 1840s, the needle gun had been revolutionary. It was the first mass-produced breech-loading single-shot rifle in military use. However, it suffered certain defects, it was heavy, and the breech closure was uncertain, resulting in the escape of gases, which made aiming sometimes an unpleasant experience. By 1870, the Dreiser was becoming out of date, unlike the Chassepot, which had been introduced only in the mid-1860s.
Moreover, the hard and bloodily won lessons of the American Civil War in the 1860s went unheeded by the European military powers.
The American Civil War had shown that it was possible to harness a country's industrial capacity to increase its capacity to make war. Prussia had learned this lesson, and the breech-loading Prussian artillery, manufactured by the Krupp Company, is a prime example of modern technology used to secure victory in warfare.
War with Prussia was seen as inevitable, and if France was to retain her dominance in Europe, her army's superiority needed to be unchallenged. The reality was that the flamboyantly uniformed French army was poorly organized and led, despite the considerable reforms carried out by Napoleon III.
Napoleon III's sole reason for wanting to be Emperor of France was to relive the glory of the First Empire. Bismarck, on the other hand, was a very different character. He was extremely calculating. He had one aim in mind, and that was to unify Germany under Prussia, in which he went about it in an extremely efficient and extremely premeditated manner.
Napoleon III's faith in technology led to problems on the battlefield. Ultimately, victory would not be due to one or two superior weapons, but the skill of the opposing commanders. When war began, France had a large standing army, but no clear idea of what to do with it. Enthusiastic cries of "On to Berlin" were no substitute for proper planning. In the heady excitement of July 1870, Napoleon III threw caution to the wind and personally led the invasion of the Rhineland. His general staff had no chance to plan or prepare for such a move. In Germany, it was a very different matter. The Prussian general staff had been secretly preparing for war for over 2 years. Detailed plans were drawn up, objectives set, and above all, steps were taken to ensure that all could proceed swiftly and efficiently.
Although the battles themselves sometimes resembled episodes from the Napoleonic Wars, the wars of the mid-19th century make increasing use of the industrial capacity of countries. Prussia in particular had made an exhaustive study of the role of railways in warfare. The American Civil War had shown that it was possible to move large numbers of troops very quickly using railways. The Prussians had planned their railway system with a view to making war against either France or Russia. The industrial capacity of modern states was being made use of, not merely in the mass production of weapons, but also in transporting supplies from one end of the continent to the other. Where railways did not exist, it was still necessary to use horse-drawn transport, and this would continue to be the case right through into the 20th century. The German army, for example, still used large amounts of horse transport, even in the Second World War.
The German mobilization was a massive undertaking, and by the end of July 1870, the army commander, Field Marshal Helmuth von Moltke, was poised to invade France at the head of no fewer than 460,000 men.
Generals are often accused of trying to fight a war with the lessons and tactics of the previous one. In actual fact, the Franco-Prussian War provides a rare example of one where this didn't happen. The Prussians had fought a successful war in 1866, and they learned lessons of that war and applied them very successfully in 1870 against France. The Germans had refined their artillery tactics, but they were fighting against the French with improved breech-loading rifles. So in a way, it was a reversal. The Germans had the good artillery and the poor musketry in 1870, as against the poor artillery and poor and good musketry in 1866. Unfortunately, what they hadn't appreciated was the scale of the French improvement in musketry. The chassepot was able to give a much greater rate of fire, and it made frontal attacks in the open quite murderous affairs. The French were able to lay down quite wide beaten zone of fire, and this created large swathes of land which was quite deadly to cross. You got very high casualties. Once you were through that beaten zone, you were very close to the enemy, and one gallant rush, as the saying had it, could carry through once you'd crossed this beaten zone. The trouble which they had, however, was that having crossed the beaten zone and pushed home their attacks, they developed the mentality that a well-handled attack, pressed home with determination, would always succeed.
The French, on the other hand, could only muster 240,000. But nevertheless, it was Napoleon who made the first move. For lack of any better plan, on the 2nd of August, he ordered 6 divisions across the frontier to seize Saarbrücken. But having captured the town, the French advance ground to a complete halt. The French commanders seemed unable to gain the upper hand in these opening stages of the campaign, despite the deployment of newly developed weapons such as the mitrailleuse.
In 1870, the French had a secret weapon, the mitrailleuse, a form of machine gun which they hoped would cut down advancing Prussian infantry en masse. But the mitrailleuse was not used properly. It was regarded as an artillery piece, deployed in the open, and generally smashed by Prussian artillery before it had a chance to show what it could really do. And because the weapon was so secret, there were many in the French army who had no idea how it worked.
There's a lot of myth about this. It's one of these favourite stories that there were very few people who knew how to use it because it was so secret. It was carefully locked away, ready for the Great War, and when the Great War came, nobody knew what to do. This, to some extent, is a load of nonsense. You give any soldier a gun, tell him to go away in a corner and figure out how it works, and he'll have it done in 5 minutes. The problem really was that they hadn't actually tested it in manoeuvres. Nevertheless, the Germans had a great respect for it. They did tend to attribute a lot of the failures to press home attacks to the mitrailleuse. There are continuous complaints in German after-battle reports, letters and that, about mitrailleuse fire and the distinctive crackle of the mitrailleuse. Now, to some extent, they may have been confusing this with the high rate of fire from the chassepot, just in the same way as in 1914. They rather got the impression that the British Army had a far greater allocation of machine guns, simply because the Lee Enfield was capable of such a high rate of fire. But nevertheless, the Germans were aware of the mitrailleuse, and they did feel that the mitrailleuse did give the French an advantage. The French tend to harp on about the disadvantages of the mitrailleuse. The Germans who were on the receiving end did have healthy respect for it.
All the French had actually achieved was to overextend their right wing, and von Moltke was quick to take advantage. On the 4th of August, the German counteroffensive began. 85,000 men of the Third Army, led by Prussia's Crown Prince Frederick William, marched over the frontier. Outnumbered nearly 2-1, the French commander, Marshal MacMahon, awaited the onslaught.
The Prussians quickly discovered in 1870 that frontal attacks against French infantry armed with a chassepot breech loader, which had a higher rate of fire than their own gun and a longer range, were almost suicidal. The solution to French infantry firepower was to use the superior Prussian artillery. The breech-loading Krupp guns were superior to the French in range and rate of fire, and very often, the French positions would be softened up considerably before any Prussian infantry were sent forward.
The battle was swift and brutal. The Germans pressed forward into a storm of rifle fire, which decimated their ranks and for a time brought them to a complete halt. But by early afternoon, the French right had been turned and the center pierced. A desperate cavalry charge failed to relieve the situation, and so MacMahon conceded defeat and ordered a withdrawal. Although the Germans had won victory, they had sustained almost twice as many casualties as the French, nearly all of them inflicted by the chassepot rifle.
Both sides quickly realized that sustained infantry attacks over open ground against breech-loading rifles was tantamount to suicide. At the Battle of Saint-Privat, the Prussian Guard lost 7,000 men in half an hour to French chassepot fire. By 1871, the Germans were developing a new system of infantry attacks, small groups advancing alternately using fire and movement tactics which would be seen again in the First World War.
Nevertheless, the road to Paris was now open to the Germans. The French fought another hard action at Saarbrücken before again retreating. Once more, heavy casualties were inflicted on the Germans, but an important distinction was emerging between the two armies. The Germans were prepared to act offensively and accept heavy casualties in order to take objectives, and individual officers were encouraged to use their own initiative. The French, however, seemed incapable of acting on initiative, or even of following that most basic of military maxims, marching toward the sound of the guns.
One of the curiosities of the War of 1870 is that you have this caricature of the stiff, inflexible Prussian officer and the French officer full of dash, elan and all the rest of it. In actual fact, it was quite the reverse. The Prussians were characterised all the way through the war by a flexibility which bordered on insubordination. They tended to march towards the sound of the guns, they tended to get piled in. If there was a fight going, they manoeuvred, they got in, they did what had to be done. The French, on the other hand, despite having this tradition of dash and all the rest of it, tended in practice to be very cautious and careful. That they were very unwilling to take risks, they were very unwilling to deviate from orders.
Worse still, Napoleon and his commanders considered themselves already beaten. On the 7th of August, 1870, he ordered a general retreat towards Chalons-sur-Marne.
Both the French and the Prussian cavalry were capable of making brave charges in the midst of battles. However, the French cavalry in particular failed to carry out its primary function of scouting and reconnaissance, and too often the French were outmaneuvered by Prussian armies, whose whereabouts are unknown. Although the cavalry on both sides had the theoretical capability of using breech-loading carbines, they were best known for making charges across open ground with sabres and lances like those that were used in the Napoleonic Wars. The Prussian Uhlans gained an especial reputation for daring reconnaissances, often many miles in advance of their main armies. One particularly adventurous group of Prussian Uhlans was captured while having dinner in a French inn miles in front of the Prussian lines.
After decisive defeats at Marle-la-Tour and Gravelotte-Saint-Privat on the 16th and 18th of August, the French army was finally surrounded at Sedan on the 1st of September. The Prussian staff officer, Colonel Julius von Verdi, witnessed Napoleon's defeat. Immense clouds of smoke were rising from Sedan behind the enemy's position, and we concluded that the battle was nearly at its end. We mounted our horses and rode towards the center. The rifle fire was not very heavy, and the unsteadiness of the enemy became visibly greater from minute to minute. At last, whole battalions piled their arms on the outskirts of the wood, while the men waved their handkerchiefs and surrendered. Looking to our right, we saw a winding road leading down from the heights, densely crowded with French soldiers, many thousands of them, all men who had surrendered and were coming down under escort. We chose our road along the Meuse, passing on the way more prisoners who were being escorted back. In the midst of the general crush, we chanced to meet with several of our comrades, who informed us that Napoleon had sent his sword to the king. The emperor and his whole command surrendered, and with them fell the Second Empire. A third French Republic was defiantly proclaimed, but 2 weeks later, the Germans arrived at the very gates of Paris and laid siege. There were still French armies in the field, and Paris held out in terrible conditions until the new year. But the war was lost at Sedan.
I think that the Franco-Prussian War in many ways sowed the seeds in the mind of several of the generals who followed in the following century. It set an awful lot of patterns of warfare, both good and bad. In some ways, the rather limited success of, for example, the Prussian cavalry led to the retention of heavy cavalry in several of the armies, which was a bad feature. At the same time, it was extremely clear that one of the main reasons why the Prussians won the war was their superior use of technology, not only in weapons, but in logistics as well.
When it finally came, The surrender of Paris brought with it a general armistice and the belated end of the war. In Prussia, triumphant victory parades resounded through the streets of Berlin, displaying the captured French eagle standards. And King William was pronounced Kaiser of the new empire. Bismarck had achieved his goals with blood and iron. France was defeated, and the German Empire united under the mastery of Prussia.
In 1871, France was defeated, quite decisively defeated. But to some extent, they viewed it in a fairly positive light. They sat down and thought about it. They decided we lost the war because, and tried to modify the tactics and the strategy accordingly. Unfortunately, they drew the wrong lessons, largely because the Germans had got away with it. They took the view that the Chassepot had to some extent let them down. What they'd seen were German attacks coming in against that breech loading rifle and succeeding. They therefore decided, look, the reason we lost the war was we'd done it all wrong, we should have stuck to the bayonet. The traditional French elan will do that next time the war comes, because they knew that sooner or later there would be a next time. They were determined there would be a next time. In 1914, that next time came. They went to war against Germany. They went forward with the bayonet using the old French elan and discovered that breech-loading weapons had come further and there were more machine guns, and they went into a bloody massacre.
In Paris, however, the suffering was only beginning. France's newly elected National Assembly favoured the peace terms laid down by Bismarck, but the radical Republicans and Socialists in Paris were determined to continue fighting, deeming the terms humiliating. On the 17th and 18th of March, the Parisians rose up against the National Assembly. They established a proletarian dictatorship in Paris, and on the 26th of March, elected a municipal council, which became known as the Paris Commune, and its members, the Communards.
I think the tragedy of the Commune was that after all of this heroic struggle that France had gone on as a nation, there was yet more to come. Whereas so often happens in the wake of a major warfare, there was civil conflict and civil unrest, which was every bit as bitter as some of the fighting that had gone on before. And the human cost to the people of Paris was far greater in some of the events of the Commune than anything that had preceded it with the Prussian siege.
The Paris Commune is one of those events in history that has gone down in the iconography, if you like, of certain groups. In particular, left-wing historians and the left in general look to the Paris Commune as a great symbol of revolutionary spirit. But there's always been a debate about whether the Paris Commune itself was revolutionary in its conception or whether it became revolutionary as it developed. And the answer is, it was both. There were elements of the Paris Commune that harked back to the French Revolution of 1789. A lot of the slogans were the same, a lot of the names of the institutions that they set up, such as Committee of Public Safety, all harked back to that revolution. And for many of the communards, it was, if you like, a rediscovery of the French revolutionary spirit, which they felt had been betrayed by recent events in the Franco-Prussian War.
The Commune proposed many measures for the benefit of Parisian workers and their families, and was organized chiefly along the lines of the old Paris arrondissement, or districts.
The kind of organizations that were involved in the Commune, and those to which historians put some emphasis, were organizations such as the French branch of the First International, although as then it was the International Working Men's Association, the French trade unionists, Blanquists, who were left-wing revolutionaries, Proudhonists, and so on. Now, at the time, labour organisation was actually very poor. In France, most industry was still based on small workshops, and in those circumstances, organised labour is very difficult. And in fact, Marx grumbled about the inefficiency and lack of organisation of the French branch of the International. So they were simply not well organised enough to be able to start the Commune and to keep it going. But the Parisians were drawing from a considerable experience of revolutionary action. Now, in the context of Paris in the time of the Franco-Prussian War, What that meant was spontaneous popular action, taking to the streets, burning a few houses, and, it has to be said, attempting to overthrow governments. And the Parisians themselves had a reputation for overthrowing governments because they'd done so on three occasions in the recent history, 1789, 1830 and 1848. They had managed to topple national governments. And in a sense, the revolutionary nature of the Commune was just that. It was drawing from this traditional revolutionary nature of French politics rather than socialist politics per se.
Before most of the work could take effect, however, the National Assembly, under its chief executive, Adolphe Thiers, sent troops to suppress what he condemned merely as a criminal revolt.
The Commune really started when the Thiers government sent in regular troops to seize the National Guard artillery. That was the point at which the Commune proper came into being. The troops entered Paris, and unfortunately for their officers, they began to fraternise with the Parisians, who, while they were feeding them, and let's not forget, we're talking about demoralised, defeated troops here who were practically starving. They were being fed by the populace of Paris, while at the same time, those Parisians were berating them for what they were trying to do in seizing the guns. In the event, some of the soldiers arrested their own general and shot him, and that was the point at which the Commune proper occurred. Thiers, who was present at the attempted seizure of the guns, took alarm and fled the city in the first available coach. And he scribbled a note to all government institutions that remained in Paris to leave Paris.
For 2 months, from the 2nd of April 1871, Paris endured a second siege, perhaps even more bitter than that fought against the Prussians. France fell into the horrific turmoil of civil war.
We must remember that the very existence of the Commune, whether or not it was likely to succeed, scared the European bourgeoisie witless. That's all bourgeois elements of any country, whatever country in Europe. The Thiers government, has been accused with some justice of peddling lightly with the Prussians. Now, there was an accusation at the time that while they were pursuing peace with the Prussians, they did so out of fear of their own people. And one of the accusations is that Thiers, above all else, wanted to avoid a revolt of the French people, which was on the cards because the French people were very, very demoralised and very angry about what had happened. They felt that the peace that had been made with the Prussians was a dishonourable peace, and that had the government had the will, they could have taken to the field and defeated the Prussians. So there was enormous fear of a revolt. One of the significant things about the Commune, and one of the things that many, many commentators have remarked upon, is the fact that at the beginning it had a holiday atmosphere, a festival atmosphere. And one commentator went so far as to say that it had all the appearances of simply being a holiday. Of course, later on, after the French army had breached the walls of Paris, the atmosphere changed considerably. Some have claimed that the Paris Commune was purely socialist. I mean, that's complete nonsense. In its origins, in its conception, the people of Paris thought they were contributing to the war effort in the Franco-Prussian War. Their first instincts were patriotic, and to some extent right-wing republican. Their instincts were to mobilise to see off the Prussian enemy. As the Commune developed, of course, it took on socialist undertones and sometimes overtones. But the word itself was a very vague word, and certainly for the communal, it was a word of considerable imprecision and vagueness. Many of the people within the Commune would describe themselves as socialists, some would describe themselves as anarchists, some would describe themselves as Catholic Republicans. So in point of fact, the Commune was many things to many people. It was not a uniform phenomenon.
The conflict at the barricades intensified from May the 21st to the 28th. And this savage time became known thereafter as Bloody Week.
It's difficult for people in a civilized society to understand the real human consequences of the events, which for us seem to be a dry history book. But if you consider that the people in Paris at the time were actually reduced to eating rats, and rats actually became a scarce delicacy with a price that was continually rising, you begin to understand just how desperate those people actually were. They ate all the animals in the zoo, and then they had to turn to rat hunts throughout the streets of Paris to actually find any kind of protein. If you can put yourself and your family into that kind of predicament, you begin to understand that these aren't dry events, these have a terrible human cost.
On the 28th of May, 1871, the Paris Commune finally fell. Over 20,000 male, female, and infant communards were slaughtered without mercy in a series of savage reprisals. In turn, the remaining Parisians shot hostages, burned public buildings, and tore down France's famous symbols of past glories, such as the Victory Column in the Place Vendôme.
Although the only commune that we hear of during this period is the Paris Commune, in point of fact, there were attempts to set up similar institutions in other cities. For example, Lyon, Marseille, Toulouse, Narbonne, Saint-Étienne and Le Creusot all declared their own communes. Lyon, incidentally, declared a commune at the instigation of the famous revolutionary Bakunin, Michael Bakunin, although it collapsed within a few days. And in fact, all of these other communes collapsed very rapidly after they were set up. And it was the Paris Commune which has drawn our attention because it lasted so long and because, comparatively speaking, it was so well organised. Although I have to say comparatively, because when you look very closely at the way the Commune was organised, it was actually quite inefficient, quite badly run, and was destined to fail in the end.
I think the tragedy of the story of the Commune was that after the terrific struggle that had preceded it, you then had, as so often happens after a major war, a period of civil unrest, which is sometimes more vicious and violent and has far greater consequences for the citizens of Paris, even than the events of the Prussian siege which had preceded it.
Paris, once the most magnificent city in Europe, perhaps the world, was in ruins, and the Emperor of the French defeated. A new European order stood victorious over the ashes of the Franco-Prussian War. Germany was in the ascendant, and the countdown to World War had begun.